Allora, buonasera a tutte e a tutti. Lanciamo subito il video che riassume la prima parte di tutto il lavoro che è stato svolto fino ad oggi a Domus Artis Residency e successivamente vi spieghiamo chi siamo, cosa facciamo e quanti siamo stasera, perché ne siamo, che ne siamo tanti, quindi però ecco, lanciamo il video però prima che traduciamo.
Welcome everybody, good evening. We are pleased to launch the video for introducing you what are we doing and who we are.
Ok. Iniziamo?
Io mi chiamo Emanuele Chissò.
Ciao, sono Fabio Zecchi.
Asema, management Siena.
Bonjour, je m'appelle Alain.
Sono Maurizio Nocera, 72 anni, vengo da Lecce.
Bonjour, je m'appelle Joan Tamel.
Bonjour, je m'appelle Myriam Mindou.
My name is Katsel.
Ciao, io sono Maristella Mattella.
Je me présente, je m'appelle Henri.
Buongiorno a tutti, sono Chiara Mambro.
Ciao, sono Carmelo Cipriani.
My name is Alexis Iannarino.
Ciao, sono Anna Paola Pressa.
Buonasera, sono Vincenzo Santoro.
Sono Valentina Gioia Levi.
La residenza, che la cui prima edizione, insomma quest'anno è la prima edizione di questo progetto, è un progetto internazionale e indipendente che propone ad artiste e curatrici, quindi a delle donne, di venire a Gagatina, di installarsi in questa casa, di fare della ricerca, quindi fare un lavoro di ricerca sul fenomeno del tarantismo.
Quindi oggi parlavamo del Global Sound, il sud globale.
E essayer d'associer le sud de l'Italie et Puglia avec le nord Pas-de-Calais, donc donc essayer de définir les contours, les frontières d'une Méditerranée élargie de l'Europe.
I thought immediately of Myriam Mindou because Brexit, as you will learn in a little bit, is very close to some of the things that I've seen in, for example, the documentary of Ernesto Martino.
Io sono nato in una famiglia nel 1947, nella quale il tarantismo era presente, in un paesetto agricolo non molto lontano da qui.
Guardando, interrogando le persone che sono anche molto reticenti, quelle che hanno vissuto veramente o anche solo osservato, questo perché era un tabù, una cosa di cui ci si vergognava.
In Cile si votò la fine della dittatura, ci misero 3 anni perché questa la fine della dittatura accadesse veramente e Pinochet fu esiliato.
Perché a noi fa piacere che noi abbiamo fatto la taranta della realtà di noi c'era la
vivant ou qu'on va être comme
comme ce qui s'est passé en Algérie. On ne savait pas ce qui allait nous passer, mais pour moi, j'observais toujours les gens, j'observe la société.
Je dois faire une analyse de mon expérience personnelle, c'est que moi, j'appartiens à une culture inhabituelle de très longtemps, et où la tradition orale véhicule des savoirs aussi qui sont essentiels pour pouvoir servir, je dirais, pour pouvoir préparer, pour soigner et pour pouvoir retrouver des espaces de rêve et d'imagination.
Un programma di residenze per artiste e curatrici internazionali che vengono in questa città galatina per studiare, scoprire e cercare di creare dei legami tra le varie sul tarantismo, scusate, cercando di creare dei legami con le proprie culture.
Artist Domus Residency is an international artist residency where artists and curators from all over the Mediterranean area comes for sharing and meeting up around the theme of Tarantism.
Domus è una casa collocata nel centro storico di Galatina, proprio dietro la chiesa di Santa Caterina. Ed è una casa tipica salentina, la struttura anche architettonica è tipica salentina, con le volte a botte a stella, e diventa appunto un luogo in cui le artiste e le curatrici, insieme a un tessuto in realtà di intellettuali, curatori, direttori di centri d'arte, di musei, di istituzioni, passa per Galatina, resta un determinato periodo e insieme cerchiamo di in qualche modo riscrivere una specie di controstoria del tarantismo.
Ok, Domus is a typical house in the historical center of Galatina, which welcome artists and curators, but also great networks of art lovers and art supporters, where is a meeting point for for rewrite the history of Tarantism, basically, and actualize through contemporary art languages.
Fondatori del concetto di Domus siamo io e Mauro Bordin, entrambi artisti italiani con storie incrociate tra il nord e il sud, che ci siamo a un certo punto incontrati a Parigi, e io dopo quasi 40 anni di frequentazione del Salento ho coinvolto anche Mauro in questa mia passione e in questo mio studio approfondito del sud Italia come artista, e insieme abbiamo comprato questa casa che appunto è la sede del progetto Domus.
Romina De Novellis and Mauro Bordin are the founders of Domus Artist Residency, and they both are artists which are crossing crossed culturally. They live in Paris, but they are both Italian, Romina from Naples and Mauro from Padova. They have created this artist residency here in Galatina.
Chiaramente non potremmo fare tutto questo lavoro perché quest'anno passeranno comunque tra appunto artiste, curatrici eccetera eccetera una quarantina, forse anche una cinquantina di persone da tutto il mondo, ma senza una validissima equipe locale che non è soltanto un team di accompagnamento ma sono tra i co-organizzatori, anche i co-fondatori in qualche modo di tutta l'iniziativa che si fa qua sul territorio. E che sono Nunzia Perrone, che adesso svolge anche il ruolo di traduttrice, perché insomma noi siamo proprio, possiamo fare tutto, ci chiamate e facciamo tutto, poi Gigi Rigliacco, che invece appunto è seduto lì, apre bottiglie d'acqua, ma che magari le vendi pure, facciamo dei soldi.
Sono Mr. P, quello gli risolve i problemi.
Magari qualcuno vuole l'acqua, ci facciamo una cassa che per Domus, che è appunto un progetto indipendente, quindi che sono i due galeristi locali di Galatina che non ha per forza strutture istituzionali legate principalmente all'arte contemporanea, ma che vede sul territorio due gallerie di arte contemporanea che già insomma di suo quindi è una storia anomala e atipica nel panorama dell'arte contemporanea. E chiaramente gli angeli custodi Paulina Rossignol e Erika Mangione, che lavorando a cavallo tra Londra, Parigi e Galatina hanno organizzato il dietro le quinte di tutto questo grande lavoro.
Ok, thanks to the KIP which is collaborating with Domus and really making it happening and supporting a lot, which are Nunzia Perrone, now active in the translation, and Gigi Rigliacco. We are doing everything with extreme versatility and by ourselves in this moment, because the lack of our territory of institution in contemporary art and at the moment of support.
And Pauline, Eric.
Pauline, sorry, and of course for our angels, which are Pauline and Erika, which are the assistants of management in this project.
Allora, questo progetto è nato prima di tutto da un progetto artistico che ho sviluppato l'anno scorso e che vedete nella fotografia aveva coinvolto tantissimi attori locali. Nella foto vedete il professore Eugenio Imbriani, Paolo Mele, che è il direttore di Random e che avete visto nel video, il suo curatore assistente Claudio Zecchi e Gigi Rigliacco. Avevo presentato l'anno scorso un progetto che appunto cercava di abbandonare il fenomeno del tarantismo come fenomeno culturale e folcloristico legato al vostro territorio e cercando invece di proiettarlo appunto già in quanto artista in un'azione performativa che gli dava quindi un respiro e un'ampiezza diciamo più intellettuale, più culturale e più concettuale. E quindi, e finisco, vai alla slide dopo, ho camminato a piedi dall'alba partendo alle 5.30 del mattino dalla cappella di San Paolo dove le tarantate venivano a chiedere la grazia, ho attraversato tutto il Salento a piedi in una giornata arrivando fino alla punta più estrema del nostro paese, ma che il nostro paese si include in una parte dell'Occidente e in una parte dell'Europa, e mettendo a seguito, insomma accompagnandomi a seguito una serie di donne salentine che non solo hanno supportato il progetto ma hanno condiviso l'idea, cioè questa evoluzione del parlare del tarantismo, innanzitutto facendolo al femminile, cioè facendo parlare anche le donne contemporanee sul tarantismo, e poi appunto mettendoci direttamente proprio in azione.
This project starts, this concept I would say starts from a project of Romina collaborating with Paolo Mele and Claudio Zecchi from Random
Imbriani
and Professor Imbriani, and it was a work called Arachne, based on Tarantism and consisting in a procession from the city of Galatina to the extreme land of Santa Maria di Leuca, which was highly metaphoric, and it was a kind of a different vision of the and an actualization of the phenomenon and the folklore.
With a cultural approach,
exactly.
And a conceptual action, then we try to leave the folkloric aspect of this phenomenon.
Actualizing in a different and new perspective.
A seguito di mentre camminavo abbiamo visto questa casa e l'abbiamo comprata. Andata super giù così, all'incirca così. Insomma,
pronto?
Sì. Però, allora, per riscrivere la storia del tarantismo, cercando appunto di renderlo contemporaneo, la prima domanda che ci siamo chiesti è: chi sono le tarantate oggi e quali sono le terre del rimorso? Quindi, prego.
Okay, thank you. Rewriting the history of the tarantismo was the aim when they managed to meet this house here in Galatina and decide to bought it, basically. So, who are the new Tarantate is the first question now.
Yeah, and where do they come from?
Where do they come from?
In questa prima parte di residenze abbiamo ospitato un'artista africana, quindi siamo subito arrivati nel cuore delle problematiche del Mediterraneo attuali, Miriam Mindou, che invece ci creava poi un ponte con il nord, con l'estremo nord dell'Europa. Abbiamo avuto quindi la curatrice Rikke Jorgensen dalla Danimarca, Henri Guett da Parigi, che ha fatto invece una riflessione sul porto di Calais, quindi il porto che invece lega l'Europa all'Inghilterra, per finire con due invece presenze locali, Claudio Zecchi appunto di Random di Cagliano del Capo e Maristella Martella, etnocoreografa e danzatrice, che entrambe queste realtà sono collocate ancora più a sud di Galatina, quindi nell'estrema ancora nel territorio ancora più estremo del Salento.
Okay, the first, I'm not an official translator, so you will forgive me, but this first start was a public talk round table where in the residency where Miriam Mihindu, an African artist, was invited, linked with a Danish curator coming from Copenhagen, and with the cooperation of
Henri
Guett, a French curator, which brought some very interesting links with the same problematic of the migrants in the port of Calais, and Claudio Zecchi from Random, and Maristella Martella, ethno-dancer from Random, extreme lands of this territory, which are in Santa Maria di Leuca.
Il secondo talk ci ha portato invece a riflettere sulle questioni del tarantismo legate proprio invece al corpo, alla presenza del corpo nello spazio pubblico, ricordando delle dinamiche performative dell'arte contemporanea e creando quindi un legame molto stretto tra i fenomeni di anche artistici che in qualche modo creano un effetto di ribellione al sistema stesso nel quale si vive. Quindi ci siamo proiettati in un'analisi di fine del mondo, inteso chiaramente metaforicamente come Global South, quindi dove inizia e dove finisce questo sud del mondo, e come in effetti ci siano dei legami diretti tra arte e politica attraverso anche un'arte che si impone attraverso il corpo.
Ok, the second talk was based on the second residency where and it was based around the concept of the body, and especially it was connected to politics and regarding the idea and the concept of global south, how the body is perceived, and the analysis of a metaphor, the end of the world as provocation.
I nostri ospiti erano l'artista quindi tunisina Mouna Jemal, che ci ha parlato delle primavere arabe, del cambiamento, del passaggio quindi politico e anche culturale che è stato importante in quegli anni, in questi recentissimi anni. Valentina Levi, curatrice invece esperta del territorio africano che, e indiano, che invece viene da Roma. Chiara Mambro, una producer indio-italiana che lavora invece in Cile, organizzando eventi culturali tra l'Italia e il Cile. Carmelo Cipriani, un critico e curatore invece pugliese.
Okay, the guests of this second residency were Mouna Jemal, artist from Tunisia, and she talked about the Arab Springs and the politics in her country. And Valentina Levy, curator and expert in African art, she brought up the theme regarding the Global South. And Chiara Mambro, producer, she lives in Chile, and she was a producer, and she does events between Italy and Chile with the presence also of Carmelo Cipriani, art critic, which contributed to the talk.
Domus Artis Residency ha anche una serie di programmi collaterali, incredibile da crederlo visto che siamo un progetto indipendente, che ospita una serie di intellettuali invece delle vostre istituzioni locali, soprattutto l'Università di Lecce, direttamente in casa per incontrare gli artisti e i curatori e parlare invece proprio del fenomeno del tarantismo, per far capire anche a livello proprio intellettuale che cos'era, quindi non bypassare, non tralasciare questo aspetto che appunto pur trattandolo in maniera trasversale consideriamo importante introdurlo da un punto di vista storico. E quindi abbiamo avuto Maurizio Nocera, abbiamo avuto Vincenzo Santoro e poi degli eventi collaterali più legati proprio invece alla creazione contemporanea, una realizzazione dei lavori di Mouna Jemal che nonostante abbia trascorso qui solo una settimana è stata in grado di fare già un punto attraverso il suo lavoro sulla sua sensazione e percezioni del tarantismo e che è stata accolta dalla Galleria di Gigi Rigliaco. È un incontro invece più trasversale in cui i tarantati forse erano gli artisti con cui lavora Rafael Castoriano, un agente e producer di New York che è stato invece accolto dalla Galleria 100 Gallery per appunto raccontarci la realtà invece newyorkese.
Ok, Domus Artis Residency has also triggered and developed other collateral events which were some talks with Vincenzo Santoro and Maurizio Nocera talking about the tarantism and triggering the consciousness in the local people especially. Mouna Jemal hosted an exhibition at the Gigi Rigliaco Gallery and Rafael Castoriano, a producer, artist, and art advisor, had a public talk sharing his experience and talking about his projects in Agento Gallery.
Nell'evoluzione logica quindi di questa controstoria in qualche modo che stiamo tentando di riscrivere del tarantismo, oggi parleremo invece della censura e della repressione, focalizzandoci prima di tutto nell'arte chiaramente, poi affronteremo invece la vera censura e la vera vergogna nel vero fenomeno del tarantismo domani con il professor Imbriani che verrà a Domus a parlare invece di quanto vergognoso e tabù fosse invece il fenomeno all'interno della vita, del quotidiano intima delle persone. E per questo motivo abbiamo invitato ancora una volta da diverse parti del territorio europeo e non solo, alcuni professionisti del settore dell'arte per parlare appunto del rifiuto della trasgressione, dell'oppressione, della differenza che spesse volte diventa un limite anche nei linguaggi dell'arte, soprattutto se istituzionalizzati.
Okay, censorship and repression in art is the topic of
il Palais de Tokyo e il tessuto artistico parigino, quindi Marie-Ange Molonguet che per anni ha diretto l'Espace Louis Vuitton di Parigi, quindi lo spazio d'arte contemporanea di Louis Vuitton, Maya Sashue, che invece ha dei legami con tutti gli amici del Palais de Tokyo, e quindi appunto gli amici del Palais de Tokyo si intendono appunto tutte le persone che sostengono i mecenati praticamente del Palais de Tokyo, che è il museo d'arte contemporanea parigino, e tanti altri, Selvan, Karin, che lavorano tutti nel campo dell'arte contemporanea, creando appunto questi legami direttamente tra il tessuto della ricerca degli artisti e l'istituzione, o attraverso le acquisizioni o attraverso l'attribuzione dei premi, sia tutte le persone che vi ho citato sono nelle commissioni per esempio del premio Marcel Duchamp, quindi attribuiscono anche i premi ad artisti affermati dei parigini, ma anche attribuiscono anche il premio della scoperta, non so dirlo in italiano, della découverte, quindi di giovani artisti del Palais de Tokyo, quindi insomma sono persone che creeranno anche dei legami poi con le istituzioni parigine, probabilmente.
Quindi sono anche persone ben preparate, persone che se parleranno bene verranno sicuramente prese sul serio.
Vabbè,
quindi,
certo, chiaramente.
Allora, non sono delle persone qualunque, cioè non saranno i commenti o ci auguriamo
che stiano
bene
qua.
Qui e che quindi possano fare anche una buona pubblicità.
Je ne traduis pas, mais bon, vous avez compris que j'ai quand même remercié votre présence ici, che per noi è très important parce que ça crée un lien direct avec la France, notre autre pays d'appartenance, de culture et de langue. Donc on est vraiment ravis de votre présence ici, enchantés et très touchés par votre générosité, votre acte, voilà, d'être venu jusqu'à ici et nous soutenir avec ce projet indépendant au bout de l'Europe. Voilà, merci beaucoup d'être ici à vous aussi.
Alors je ne rappelle pas très bien le français, mais je vous souhaite une bonne vacance.
Ah, voilà.
Il y a beaucoup d'années que je ne parle plus français, mais quelques mots encore je le rappelle.
Ah bah super.
Buonasera a tutti.
Grazie mille. Allora iniziamo con Whisper, quindi e Michela. Special guest.
Special guest, allora abbiamo un invitato un po' dell'ultimo momento che insomma ci fa molto piacere accogliere, che interverrà anche lui, è Bruno Di Marino, che ci parlerà quindi della censura anche lui, ha fatto una bellissima pubblicazione, un libro sull'arte e la pornografia, quindi insomma non dimentichiamole qua e ci parlerà.
No, è vero, che tra l'altro in queste diverse opzioni, lui ha già fatto anche l'autista, tra l'altro.
No, ma io sono imboscato,
quindi ha fatto svolto anche la
funzione. Driver.
Del driver di chauffeur.
Only driver.
Allora, invertiamo i tempi e i ruoli che avevamo previsto, perché avremmo dovuto cominciare con l'artista e la curatrice per omaggiare la loro presenza da Kiev, insomma andiamo rispetto ai chilometri, noi facciamo parlare prima quelli che vengono più lontano, poi quelli che invece
loro vogliono per ultimi.
Invece quelli che stanno dietro l'angolo devono andare via velocemente, quindi li facciamo parlare per primi. Però nella logica della conversazione di oggi volevamo partire da Kiev e dall'Unione Sovietica, dall'ex Unione Sovietica, per poi finire di nuovo in Salento col tarantismo Edoardo e Michela. Cominciamo?
Sì, iniziamo.
Allora, intanto io mi presento, appunto sono direttrice, sono molto semplicemente una libraia, con orgoglio, perché martedì prossimo la mia libreria compie 15 anni e sono di Alessano, una libreria idrusa ad Alessano, sono una operatrice culturale e ho avuto la fortuna di lavorare, tra le mie primissime esperienze extra, diciamo, studio, e io ho studiato anche cinema e ho avuto l'occasione di lavorare come assistente di Edoardo Muisby nella mia vita precedente sul set di Sangue Vivo, un film girato appunto nel Capo di Leuca, e quindi sono qui in veste di intervistatrice, di in qualche modo presentatrice e intervistatrice di quello che è un po' il grande narratore, no, della cultura salentina.
Ok, Michela, she owns and directs a library in Alessano, which is in the very south of our territory, and she's very pleased to be here and to interview Edoardo Whisper, which she has already the opportunity to meet and work with. And she will be pleased this evening to interview him.
Allora, intanto lo presento, no? Molto velocemente, perché per capire un po' il percorso di Edoardo prima di arrivare un po' al tarantismo, alla grande narrazione del tarantismo che lui ne ha fatto.
Ok, she will introduce us Edoardo and his path before arriving at the topic of tarantismo.
Lui è in assoluto il protagonista e l'artefice della riscoperta del patrimonio culturale popolare salentino, anche se non lo direbbe mai, ma è così.
He is absolutely the pioneer, I would say, in the rediscovery of the tradition of Tarantism here in Salento, despite it would never have been.
E questo a partire dai primi anni 90, ed è stato certamente appunto Edoardo, regista e sceneggiatore, e autore di diversi film che hanno raccontato in vario modo il Salento, e due in particolare, Pizzicata e Sangue Vivo, ambientati nel mondo della musica popolare salentina.
Ok, starting from the 90s, Edoardo, filmmaker and scriptwriter. He envisioned and started to talk about Tarantism with two very iconic and famous movies, films, which talk about our territories, Sangue Vivo and Pizzicata.
Pizzicata in particolare.
Pizzicata especially, which is very much about the music, ethno and tarantism.
E Pizzicato appunto è il suo primo lungometraggio, un vero e proprio atto d'amore per l'antica cultura contadina del Salento, ormai quasi scomparsa, spazzata via dal progresso e anche da fenomeni di modernizzazione di pasoliniana, no? Visione.
Okay. Pizzicata was an act of love. Pizzicata was a film, more an act of love in regard of our rural culture and the folklore and Pizzica dance and music.
E già in precedenza, nel corso dei suoi studi alla Scuola di Monaco, alla Scuola di Cinema di Monaco, Winspear era, Edoardo era stato attratto dal fenomeno del tarantismo e nel 1989 aveva girato il documentario San Paolo e la Tarantola, un'esperienza che gli ha consentito di conoscere gli ultimi depositari della cultura legata al tarantismo e alla musica.
From his studies in Munich, he was Edoardo Winspear was tremendously attracted by the phenomenon of tarantism, starting with the project film San Paolo e la Tarantola, which gave to him the possibility to come in touch with the depositary musicians. With the real old and authentic musicians of territory.
Tra questi Luigi Stefani, lo ricordiamo, l'ultimo Stefani, violinista terapeuta delle Tarantate di Nardò.
The last violinist shamanic therapist of Tarantino.
Col violino curava le tarantate e anche i cantori, gli anziani cantori come Uccio Luisi e Uccio Bandello, nomi che non dicono nulla, invece sono come dire i cardini, no, della nostra cultura popolare.
And other very traditional old singers like Uccio Bandello
e Uccio Luisi. Poi anche per altre esperienze in contesti differenti, come per esempio in Andalusia, se non sbaglio, dove avevi realizzato un documentario come fonico, avevi collaborato ad un documentario sul flamenco, ti rendi conto che il tarantismo è un elemento fortemente identitario per Salento.
Ok, also with other works in Andalusia, in Spain, he reached more awareness regarding the tarantism as a phenomenon of connected to the identity of his origins, this place.
E che lega appunto il Salento al Mediterraneo,
Salento al Mediterraneo,
al Nord Africa, alla Grecia, alla Turchia, e una sorta di limes tra mondo latino e mondo greco. E il suo interesse però non è solo storico e soprattutto sociale, perché poi la pizzica e il tarantismo diventano degli strumenti di mobilitazione quasi sociale, no? Perché nasce un vero e proprio laboratorio culturale che poi porta alla nascita del progetto del film Pizzicata.
Ok, his project becomes more of a workshop and a laboratory of creation, which will bring them at the creation of Pizzicata.
E intorno a Edoardo si crea un vero e proprio laboratorio, appunto, e nasce questo film con, tra l'altro, un po' come una sorta di residenza, partecipano tantissimi studenti di varie scuole di cinema europee, quindi una sorta di antesignano anche da questo punto di vista. E appunto nasce Pizzicata, il film è ambientato negli anni della Seconda Guerra Mondiale, in particolare nel 1943.
Ok, around Pizzicata there is a ferment of it was a laboratory indeed, and there was a ferment. It was a residency because actually many artists and students from the academies of cinema get closer and joined this project, contributing to the creation of Pizzicata.
Diceva appunto la storia ambientata nel 1943.
The history of this film is in the years after the Second World War.
E nelle campagne salentine.
And in the countryside of Salento.
Dove una famiglia contadina salva e accoglie in casa un soldato italo-americano scampato ad un incidente aereo.
Where a family from Salento save and give hospitality to an American soldier which was escaped by an accident in the airplane.
E come spesso accade, tra una delle figlie appunto di questa famiglia e il soldato italo-americano nasce un amore.
As it often happened between the daughter of this family and the soldier start love.
Ma lei è già promessa al figlio di un proprietario terriero, per cui non può ovviamente ricambiare questo amore.
But she is already promised to another man, a rich man who owns lands.
E ora lo svegliamo, il soldato poi viene ucciso dal rivale in amore e Cosima, la protagonista, e preda a questo profondo dolore, diventa tarantata.
And the soldier was killed by the other guy, and Cosima, the protagonist of the movie, for the pain, became tarantata.
Quindi al centro della narrazione, appunto, Edoardo racconta la storia di Cosima che rifiuta di amare un uomo imposto dal padre e che sceglie suo malgrado di essere considerata una tarantata, una pazza.
Ok, at the center of the plot there is the role of Cosima, which refuses to accept the obligations and the rules of a society and choose to become a tarantata.
Sì. E il film si apre e si chiude con una scena, una danza delle tarantate davanti alla cappella di San Paolo, ed è forse il momento anche di vedere questa scena.
Ok,
preciso in inglese.
Traduciamo in italiano per cambiare anche lingua.
Ok, magari gli italiani parlano inglese.
Maybe Italian speak English. Yeah.
Se no diventa.
Because
è bravissima.
Everybody speak English.
I will speak in English. Ok.
Come vuoi, da dove vuoi iniziare? La prima scena?
No,
ok. This is the end of the film. This is the end of the film. Then Eduardo chose to finish the film with this dance and scene about
la morte dell'innamorato.
About the
after the death
of his love, her love.
Sorry. Kind sort of refugee
Santa Cosima, l'hai pizzicata da rampa. Andiamo a commentare per gli stranieri che non sanno forse così sono efficienti Gardino. No, scusa, perché non sono delle
interesse. She's bitten by the tarantula. The tarantula is a sort of metaphor of the evil. She decides to be considered a crazy woman because of her love sorrows. So the ritual is like this. The tarantate are. Have a diagnosis from the capi a tarantate. They decide if the tarantata is a red taranta or a black taranta, the tarantata dell'amore. They play pizzica tarantata. She reacts to the music and she's been healed for 1 year. She is healed with the music and with the help of Saint Paul, who is a Saint patron of the tarantata. It sounds very strange, but it happens like this. Anyway, you know about Tarantino. This happens in May, in June, and this is called la terapia domiciliare. The 29th of June, the day of Saint Paul, all the tarantate from the region, from Puglia, gather here in front of the chapel of San Paolo, and they ask the grace. Actually, they already had the grace. It's a sort of theater. They do the same thing they did at home. Okay. So this was the ritual at home, and now it's in Gardino. Is the very beautiful documentary called Taranta di Gozzo. He is a very good, very famous Italian documentary who helped me at the beginning. She's the mother of a man who gave me money. Ma gli italiani, lo dico in italiano velocemente, conoscono tutte queste cose, no? E poi magari capite pure l'inglese, poi probabilmente avete visto i miei film, quindi sono sempre qua da 25 anni.
Va benissimo così.
No, this is my first long feature film, and it was actually a school diploma film. It was the last film. The last film of the film school of Munich, and was made by some friends of La Fémis of Paris, of Centro Sperimentale, and there was only one professional who had experience with long feature films. Otherwise, we were all students from Munich. There was once one. The director of photography at the beginning was Spanish. We were an American makeup artist, and we had an Hungarian best boy. It was very funny because I was sorry. I così anche per fare un po' più veloce, no? I was in love with the culture of here, but I came from 10 years of living abroad, and I was a bit like a German, you know, like Goethe when he was in love in das Land wo die Zitronen blühen, in the country where the lemon flowers blooming. And I had a very romantic view of Puglia and of all the ladies, all the women were the most beautiful women of the world, and the men were Socrates, Euripide, and I don't know where. You know, I had a Mediterranean dream, and this is the result. My dear friend and assistant, Michela, she introduced me in a bit exaggerated, very gentle, and very full of love. The only thing I did is that I was the pioneer of cinema here. Already some directors shot films here, but I was the first, I can say, that I described this region with the people, with the language, with the music, with the faces, and that's why this is the only importance of my films, not the only, I don't know, but anyway. So.
Tanto, thank you for coming and thank you to show your movie without ask us some diritti d'autore or no, because and so in Italian or in English, I don't know. Traduci tu, ok. Mi hai interrotta, però non so più cosa stavo dicendo. No, quello che volevo dire è to recreate a link with this conversation, with this round table about the censorship and the sense of shame in art, then in Tarantate. And I find very interesting to start with the end of your movie, because you explain exactly what happened in the family. Cosimo Cinieri, a big actor of our cinema and theater story, and then he worked with Carmelo Bene, with a lot of art director and film director and actor in the early 60s and 70s in Italy. He is one of the protagonists of your film too, and is the father of the young woman, and he stay is this scene, I think it's very interesting. Maybe you can talk about the feeling that this father can feel to during this scene of crisis of his daughter, and what happened exactly in the family, what happened during this moment where the Tarantismo becomes true, when Tarantismo becomes physically, it embodied the body of the girl, of the young girl. This is the censorship, the sense of censorship that we try after to explain in art, and that you through the language of the cinema explain with just this scene, this moment where Cosimo Cinieri is looking in front of us, and behind on the back there is all the drama.
You explained already, so nothing to say anymore. No, it's
this was your idea.
Yes, of course. You know, the cinema is very powerful because you don't need so many words. You just need to see a father who is suffering because his daughter became a tarantata. Tarantism was both sides a taboo, but was also part of the culture. So where in the last decades became a taboo, you know, after the Second World War and let's say after the business boom, how do you say, economical boom, you know, but before everybody participated to the sorrow of the family who had a tarantata in the family. And yes, I made a documentary in 89, and I didn't know nothing about Tarantismo. I only knew some tarantata in my village, who is called Depressa, Depression. That's why we had two tarantate. And I didn't know that Ernesto De Martino wrote a book, Carpitella made some researches, I don't know, nothing. And I interviewed some tarantate or some relative of tarantate, and behind every tarantata there was always, you know, of course the lady said, ah yes, I was bitten by the tarantula in the cornfields, I was bitten, but also I dreamt a tarantula. This is also very interesting. And when I interviewed the relatives, I understood that behind this bites, there was all a big sorrow. For example, the lady was raped, or one tarantata in Copertino was cooking tomato sauce before you cook tomato sauce in very big pots, you know, and they had the little girl on her back, and she was benching, and the little girl fell in the pot, and she died. And after, you know, they didn't have psychiatrists, they were analphabet, they were very intelligent and sensitive ladies, but they didn't have they didn't know how to react to this sorrow. So it exists, Tarantismo. That's why I think it's so interesting. Okay.
Allora,
about father. I mean, I also didn't. Yeah, about father.
Se avete delle domande, if you have a question, please.
Yes. Yeah, so if the my question is, is the relative censorship in the families? Like, what was the attitude? Only caring or ashamed as well?
Of course they were caring for their relatives, but towards the exterior, they wanted to hide this this phenomenon. In fact, I was, you know, I'm a documentarist, I'm a filmmaker, and in 89 they existed, the Parentate, very.
There was a sense of shame, but I can also add that in Galatina it was particularly felt from the population of Galatina.
But Galatina, they didn't have Parentate. Galatina is the only village without Parentate, because they... because it was San Paolo here, but also because Galatina is a little city, you know, it's more middle class or nearly aristocratic more than
the other. I think the site was the center of this pilgrimage for the grace of St. Paul. The collectivity was not so open, was not so, they felt ashamed, they felt Galatina people. I tell you from family memories, from what I heard in my little storybook of my family.
Okay.
The citizen.
Io vorrei solo chiudere con... intanto ringraziarvi di
essere... Grazie a voi. Scusate, I'm very sorry. I had to be the last. It's true that I come from here, but it's true that you, the guests live in Galatina, and we live 50 kilometers, and I have my niece has birthday today. I want to
Io penso che è stato bello iniziare da te.
The last question?
Yeah, before you go, I'm interested into one thing. If you look at, just making a parallel, if you look at Zorba the Greek,
yes.
It's a movie about Crete.
Yes.
Actually, it's a very strong critic about the Greek culture of the time. Yeah. But as of now, Zorba the Greek is seen as a very nice metaphor of the, of the joyful Greeks, right? And actually, all the criticism about the Greek society has been lost. And when you look at the movie, it's a very strong criticism, actually. My question is, what was the local reception
to this film?
Of the people, when they saw this movie? We're talking about censorship, we're talking about sense of shame. Were they happy that it was displayed to the outside world? Were they ashamed? Were they angry at you? What's the
story? This was interesting. They mostly liked the film. I had some more problems with my second and third film, because my second film was about drug addicts, junkies here. And the people of Salento said, oh, we are not like this. Of course, we are not like this. But, you need to tell a story. And the third thing was about mafia.
Okay.
And Sacra Corona Unita. And so, but people were not used. We are not used to people have, this is a very old part of Italy with a long tradition of, the Messapians, the Romans, the Greeks were here, but we Italian, we are not the best readers and the best film goers of the world, especially in front of you French. And so they were astonished at the, and some people said, we are not like this, but of course, when you show a film, you show a part of the film, apart. And people of Lecce, for example, people of Lecce didn't know about Tarantismo, or very little. Or people of, we made all this movement of the pizzica, with Michela, with his brother, we said, dance pizzica, you will make better love, I was very populistic with our friends. And I had the power of cinema, because anyway, a film is very powerful, even if it's a bad film. Maybe this is a bad film, I don't know. And so we were very, we wanted, I said, we are all sons and daughters of Greece, because Greece is very, Greece is noble. Greece. It was a part of our Mediterranean dream, and it happened something. It happened something here. Okay, too long.
Grazie mille. Prego, prego. Grazie.
Svetlana, to talk about. So now we are traveling to the ex countries of the Russian socialism in the period before, yeah, Soviet Union. Sorry. Then we leave to Daria, you start now in the beginning, and Daria Pachenko, the curator of the Domus Artis Residency. She works and lives in Berlin, but she comes from Kiev. Thank you so much for coming, Daria.
Thank you so much. First of all, I would like to thank you, Romina and Mauro, for this, and all the partners and the team. For the Domus Residency, that really, where we really can, all artists and creators can feel ourselves at home, sharing and caring about, sharing like our thoughts and concepts, and taking care about the ideas and culture. We're creating here on the south of Italy cultural process, being so brave to found a new institution here and bring all the amazing people from all over the world. So thank you, first of all.
Thank you.
And I want to, my presentation will be about Ukrainian censorship and self-censorship in Ukrainian art. But I want to start and give the world first to the artist with whom I'm so happy to work and be here in Italy, Svetlana Levchenko. Usually when we talk about censorship and self-censorship, it's Then we have a question where with people, society, or trying to be so objective and, you know, giving attention to some ideology more than personalities. So Svetlana's art works always about her personality, about topics that goes from inside, about her subjectivity. So I'm giving the first word to her. She'll show you her projects and tell more about them, and then we'll go back to the censorship.
Scusate, per gli italiani, for Italian public, venite, prego, sedetevi, possiamo continuare in inglese o preferite una traduzione? Per gli italiani, siamo in Italia, quindi insomma dovremmo parlare, dare la priorità alla lingua italiana, quindi se volete possiamo tradurre oppure continuiamo il nostro talk in inglese se tutti sono comodi, insomma, nell'ascoltare il talk.
Se qualcuno non ha capito qualche particolare, magari traduciamo.
Ok, quindi continuiamo.
Hi everyone. Yeah, we can start with this and put it like this. Sorry. Hello. I'm Svetlana Levchenko. It's you, as you can see. Oh no! Stop it!
Who knows this evil machine? How to, and this beautiful language. We need to stop screen. Okay.
Hi everyone again. First of all, thank you. Thank you. When I come here, I didn't know what to expect. But I feel like at heaven, like at home. I live in heaven, yes. let's go. Sorry, I was not prepared. I thought that we will be the last one. I'm Svetlana Levchenko. I'm based in Kiev from Ukraine. Who is the hell Svetlana Levchenko? I'm artist that works with photography, and as photographer, I presented by Ukrainian photography alternative platform and Eastern Europe photography in Berlin. I have exhibitions in Rome, in LA, in Paris, in Austria, Berlin, solo exhibition here, in Ukraine. I took part in festivals in Athens, Vienna and Odessa, and so on and so on, but we will go deeper. No, I am ambassador of following the heart. I shoot everything from my heart, from myself. I am human being, first of all, and I want to tell you a corner of Avant-Garde Gallery in Kiev. We have the same problem with the art market in Ukraine as here, as I can understand from our talking at the kitchen. I can say that doesn't exist at all, but it survived somehow, if you know what I mean, in Ukraine. With a friend of mine, I started Avant-Garde to change this situation. Avant-Garde is an art project which goal is to unite, socialize, and unlock people's potential through informal study of art history, involvement in process of creating art objects, and invitation into sacrament of collecting, and emission in the world of co-creation with the all available media. that exists. Avant-Garde is an exhibition space that won't tolerate... What's going on? Thank you. Avant-Garde is an exhibition space that won't tolerate the single square centimeter of mediocrity. Avant-Garde is a restaurant lost in tropics. Avant-Garde is a series of events all over the world where we can learn and share knowledge of art of seeing, developing a culture of new thinking. We are very open to collaboration, because in my opinion, the only way to move this huge mountain is international collaboration. So, let's go to my projects. God is an artist. Oh, so I have a book, we can share it.
Yes, where is it?
In my bag, actually. You can find something interesting here. Maybe someone bites you, some tarantula. You can see. No, it's for you. You can touch it. God is an artist. With this project, I want to prove that God, universe, is an artist. For this purpose, I took pictures of everything that took my heart. Touch my heart. I shoot on analog, digital, mobile, just what I have with me. Then I burned the films, used some materials that doesn't fit printing, like cooking paper or old undeveloping photo paper, just a laser printer. I was like only like transmitter, just hands, trying not to put my nose in this project. It was just universe. Every picture is only one, it can't be repeated. Then I found on flea market the Bible in Russian, the like pocket Bible, and put there all sacral books that exist, like Torah, Quran, and then put these images there and in random order, just like I meditate, listen music, and I'm an artist, you know, and put this photo and scan this Bible. You can see in this book. The book, the some part is there.
Interference.
Yeah.
the problem of the cable is cable.
Here? Mm.
Maybe.
It's a universe, guys. This book I printed on this paper that will change color with the time. If you will put this book on the sun, it will change in a week. It's an art object that you can influence on this. I left the one page without anything. You can put something there and put on at the sun, and you will get image from the sun, from the universe. Next project is body language. It's about dancers. I start with the fashion photography. Maybe you can feel something from fashion here. Dancing is an opportunity to speak, to communicate with the world. It's I admire dancers a lot because how they use their bodies. We all have the same bodies, but they're very different. And they speak with the world with their body, and every dancer has some story that they told me with the dance when I shoot them. We start shooting, like we touch each other, we speak, we dance a little bit, and then we start shooting. Body language is a collection of stories told by heroes when they dance. Winter is for interiors. It's a series of self-portraits. Everything that I feel, I shoot. Every pain, every sorrow, everything. The only way to let my problems or past go for me, it's shooting. Dancers use dancing. I use photography. Someone use performance. Someone cooking. Maybe everyone is artist. And the way like you speak with the world, it's your language. My language is photography, I let my problems go with the self-portraits. This is a funny project. I love small, simple, funny projects to do it like a day. I spent to do this. I found in the internet, I found interesting pictures of Charles Le Brun. It's a rich year, 1749. He researched emotions. He searched for emotions. He thought that it's a passion that lives in our heart and with the blood goes to the face. And he draw these emotions, for example, this one, I repeat them, and then I connect it with nowadays and how it looks now, and the smiles is like we don't write letters, we don't use words anymore, we just put some numbers and desire, for example. Somebody is, something is very strange, emotions, he draw. Joy. It's a joy, guys, yes. I have a dummy here as well. You can see with me. And this project is You Are the Fear That I Lost. I think that woman is the basis of universe, the core of universe that put in the dirty rags of stereotypes, social roles, imposed ideals, racist complex. All this stuff splits the true woman. This project is therapy, self-therapy as well. The study of internal context, which was examined on the global map of something. I made a mistake. depending on the world of men, searching for inner beauty. As a child, I often heard from my mother, "You are not beautiful, you are just pretty." I don't know why, never said this to your child. When I asked her now, she said that, "I prepare you to the cruel world." Thank you, mom. It became an axiom for me, and with the years, a year ago, I asked myself, is it true? Start the searching for that inner woman, that true woman is perfect, and perfect is wider than just beautiful. With the help of assertive series, I illustrate the search for a true woman in myself. I found this project very similar.
What's a nice picture?
I found it very similar to Tarantismo phenomenon, to escape from slavery to freedom. That inner freedom that makes us a real woman. The decision to be honest with yourself, no matter how hard your way to yourself will be. The considered choice to stop playing the role of mother, wife, lover, hostess, whatever. You become, according to your destiny, woman with a capital letter, all in one. That's it. Thank you.
Yes, definitely. But I just want to say that the Ukrainian society is still quite conservative, and society expects from women to be a really good woman, good mother, good worker as well, but all at once. And we have actually, like many women, the same as here in Yoram Minas project, they didn't have a feeling that they need to find their rights. They feel themselves free because they already can, for example, work or vote. But all the roles that society wants to put on the women at once, it's actually super hard. And I like that, like in Svetlana, in her projects about her inner woman, she's trying not only to escape, but really to find the truth in her very personal perspective, in her life and surroundings. And talking about the woman, to other people too, yeah, in Ukraine and other countries as well. So I will start to talk more about censorship and self-censorship, but could you make the picture closer because there's some text? Maybe make it smaller? Yeah, just 75%. Yeah. Smaller? Yes. Like, too much? Olina will delete all this. Okay, so dark times, bright times, censorship and self-censorship in Ukrainian art. Before I'll talk about contemporary art and contemporary situation, I just want to make a jump quickly to the past, because as I think that for origins, Ukraine still like an invisible territory, and like it's so hard to actually to and easy maybe to talk about Ukraine because we have some myths and stereotypes. But it's really hard to to describe how deep and complicated situation sometimes. So an important period in our history was the Soviet period. And you might know Ukraine as a part of Soviet Union, of the Russian world. But I want to tell you more first about like some light. Actually, in Soviet Union, we had really a lot of censorship, a totalitarian machine, and ideology, strong ideologies that didn't allow a lot of freedom, both for artists and society. But anyway, we used to have very bright moments, and I wanted to show you next. Yeah, so Kyiv Art Institute that was founded in 1917, after the revolution, in December of 1917 actually, was founded by famous Ukrainian artists and like Fedor Krichevsky, Boychuk, and many others. So they actually created a new institution, art institution that was very important in Poland, and it was a place where new ideas were created with a very strong school where every artist had a own a group of students and trying to like experiment and give much more freedom. And that was a very good period from 1917 till 1930 until the totalitarian machine started to like cut all the freedom and even killed some students and teacher the professors from the academy. Ukrainian Kyiv Art Institute was called even like a Bauhaus, Ukrainian Bauhaus. You can see on the picture during that period the building of the Kyiv Art Institute that currently became Kyiv National Academy of Art and Architecture, but still have the problems for like no freedom, no really contemporary education for artists. Because it's still like the art education in Ukraine is still very unfree from and very influenced by Soviet system. I would say it lives just in the minds so of the professors as well and student and then students. But that was a very nice period, and you might know such a huge name, like definitely know Kazimir Malevich, and he was one of the professors at this academy. Next slide. I just want to show, so Kazimir Malevich was a professor for 3 years, and he, he before like 1927, 1929, he worked in that period. Actually, this artist was born in Kyiv, and in that period he gave a lot of new thoughts to students. He really fought with this, with the system and with the understanding of art. He inspired them by different phenomena from all over the world. And I just want to show you this picture, one of his works, and show how he was inspired by like Eastern egg motif from Ukrainian culture, from the villages, and how important these paintings become for the whole world art history. The same maybe like it's a parallel for how small local phenomena like Tarantism could be important for the whole world history, and it shouldn't be eaten by globalization like that, and it shouldn't disappear as well. Next. Soviet system just like was super influenced a lot in art, and art became a part of ideology and propaganda. But still, some artists could work more free, like more free. But it was like in a hidden place, you know, in studios only, not really sharing their ideas with society. One of this, like we had a very big and important movement in 1960s that actually was almost disappeared for us as well, for Ukrainians, and only like 3 years, 2 or 3 years. Like we had the first ever exhibition of this movement in our National Museum, and a book was written by young art critics and art historians. So this picture of, so here the picture of works of two artists, Valery Lama and Florian Yuriev. Valery Lama, you could saw this work, actually this pictures from Documenta. And actually in Ukraine, like in Documenta it was exhibited before than in Ukraine. So you can imagine the system. Next slide. Another artist from the 60s movies, this is Alexander Dubovik works, and he actually, artists couldn't have much freedom in paintings and graphics, so, but they could use public space, and actually in public space that could receive more, much more freedom for more experimental works, and this is work from 1980s. But Alexander Dubovik, so you see, for Ukraine, in Soviet Ukraine, for Soviet Union, it's a very brave piece, actually. Yeah, next one. Then I'm jumping to the end of 1987, when Ukrainian New Wave begins. It was another movement of young Ukrainian artists. Also known as Boris Communion Ukrainian Trans Avant-Garde, that you know, you're famous for the whole world, Ukrainian, Italian Trans Avant-Garde, and Benito Oliva, he actually visited Ukraine first in 1996 to meet this artist. The artist is themselves discovered Italian Trans Avant-Garde in Ukraine, I mean, Ukrainian artist, they discovered Italian Trans Avant-Garde in the end of in the beginning of 90s, and they had a feeling that they had something the same. So in that case, for the artist of this moment, because it was still Soviet period, were some like moments about censorship, definitely, because they couldn't be exhibited on the main inside of the main institutions, but only on the some young art exhibitions for young artists, and actually first they were mentioned by art critics in Moscow, because on the first on the exhibition of young artists 1998, Moscow was the center definitely of Soviet Union and intellectual center as well, but Ukraine, what I want to say and mention, that Ukraine actually was also always a south country. Because in our world of the Soviet countries, Ukraine was also some, you know, like extreme world. All this Crimea, territory of Crimea, of you know, Odessa, and all the south region. So Ukrainian art was all, in particular this wave, new wave, was also called like, oh, this is something from south and hot and warm, more winter, because the works were more winter, less cold. Then, like, less cold and less conceptual, but more vital and expression. And so, this painting by Arsen Tsivarov, The Borisation of Cleopatra's Sorrow, as well, like, really became one of the most emblematic and important for art history of all, not only in Ukraine, but actually for European art history as well. Yes, I'm there. And now we are coming to the topic censorship, and this is like already time when I was starting like working as art curator, art historian, and exhibition Ukrainian Body in the Center of Visual Culture in Kyiv. You can see one of the pieces from this exhibition, the nude guy that making selfie, or like in the picture of the mirror, and the written that my porno is my right. In Ukraine, we still have this homophobic, we still have a problem with the rights of LGBT communities, but all these problems are coming from, and censorship as well, about this topic, they're coming from idea, so like feeling that government is controlling, ideology has more power than society, than people in society. So this exhibition, for example, was closed directly after the opening, and even the Central Visual Cultures that existed at my university, Kyiv Mikhail Academy, was closed by like professors, by directors. it was an act of censorship, definitely very strong, but the team and art community fight a lot to reopen this center in another place directly in the same year. So actually these acts of censorship not tolerated anymore. I can say especially they started fight with art communities, but then when like in society I can say that now we have even more intolerance to that. Next. Another exhibition of Ruma Mayova about the Estonian project about LGBT families in Ukraine by Evgenia Belarus was fighted by right people from the right party, right organizations. So the exhibition was really broken and all the photos were scratched by guys, like you know, group of guys that came immediately to the art center and ruined it. Yeah. Another act of censorship in 2030, it was my institution where I used to work for a long time, more than three, four years, National Cultural Museum Complex Art Arsenal. Actually the biggest national museum complex, national institution, 60,000 square meters located in Kyiv. And here I would like to talk about self-censorship that we also that is also exists in Ukraine, because this was an exhibition, very important exhibition, with the pieces by contemporary artists and artists in the 20th century. And we were waiting, like directly, we were waiting for the for the president of Ukraine and some popes as well, because this institution located in front of the very famous Kyiv Печерська Лавра, huge church, super powerful one. And the artist, Volodymyr Kuznetsov, you see there are a lot of people and even more came. So 2013, and after we had a lot of discussions, even this director was important for the institution, then she left it in some time after this accident. So in Ukraine we still don't have Museum of Contemporary Art, and this is one that could be possible. Next. So the platform for discussion. And talking about myself, I would just briefly tell you, just what about what is my project, not what about. I'm an independent curator from Ukraine, living in Berlin, and actually between Kyiv and Berlin. And one of my, I have an institution called, I'm co-founder of the International Art Institution, Art Matters Ukraine, based in Kyiv, Berlin, London. Next slide, please. Our main project is a residency that we are creating, a new residency between Kyiv and Berlin. Next. Another project important for me is located in Kyiv. It's a traditional platform about a dormitory area, and it's also about local phenomenon in some particular very small thing about the one district that actually quite huge for 300,000 people, but all the it's isolated from the whole city because it's very far from the center and all the cultural life that's located only in the center of the city. And next year I will curate, this is the final slide. And so next year I'm curating the personal exhibition of Ukrainian-Tunisian artist Nadia Kabelinke, who is coming to the Domus residency just next week, so you will meet her. And she's fantastic, but known in the world more like Russian-Tunisian or only Tunisian. But so it's quite like a restitution of a live artist as well, but coming not from the, from which of art historians, like we have the situation with Malevich, but really from her own perspective. She really want to be a part of Ukraine context. So currently she actually moved from Berlin to Kyiv and works there. So I thank you for your time and passion. I'm happy to meet you.
I would like to ask you what you think about the foundation, the Pichniuk Foundation in Ukraine. Do you think
Pichniuk? Yeah, Pichniuk Foundation. This is actually, I used to work there as well.
It's a good thing for the.
Sorry?
Do you think it's positive? Do you think it's important for artists and for the reputation of your country?
I mean, definitely the institution is important. I used to work in the Junior Center for several years because in while I was a student, even begin when I was a student. For Ukraine, this is like one of the biggest private art institution. I can describe just briefly what the problem, because when the Pinchuk launched this, it founded this institution, it should be an institution where, like, with a two-way, that has a program in two-way street, so promoting Ukrainian art in the world, but and bringing our international artists and international community to Ukraine. But what we received, it's like, you know, Demenhurst's biggest collection, so like putting money and just earning the reputation for himself. But after, and the Ukrainian artists actually were forgotten, I would say. But then the Future Generation Art Prize was launched, and Pinchuk Art Prize for only for Ukrainian artists was launched. So, and these competitions for young artists became very important because they like played a huge role actually for local process. And we can criticize definitely, we should do that, private institutions with their programs. But now, what we can see, but at the same time, I must say that they are important. And currently, the situation becomes better after the Revolution of Dignity. They founded a special research platform, and that is focusing with young art historians, that is focusing particularly on Ukrainian art history, and they're doing small exhibitions, but regularly, about and publishing books. So this is what can I say? Yes, it's important. Thank you for your question.
Thank you, Daria Svetlana, for coming from Berlin, from Kiev, to show us your works, your research. We are very happy to welcome you in Galatina, and we hope that we can continue to work with you both and to develop some project in the public space, maybe. And thank you very much. Thank you for coming. Vorrei ringraziare Cristina Dettou. Cristina Dettou, beh, solo una parola almeno. Cristina Dettou is the person in charge of culture in Galatina. Thank you for coming. Thank you for. Sì, ti traduco. Thank you to be here. Thank you to support us today. And just if you want to.
If you want to dire qualcosa, tu vuoi fare. È un pubblico molto internazionale. Perché appunto ci sta il gruppo dei francesi che invece, esatto, più le artiste ucraniane, più appunto artista curatrice, più invece i nostri italiani, che quindi D'Ambroso e invece Angelo e Maria Monaco, insomma, che adesso infatti prenderanno la parola.
Buonasera a tutti, benvenuti a Galatina. Due parole, poi Romina traducerà. Però questo progetto mi è servito innanzitutto per darmi lo stimolo per imparare l'inglese finalmente, perché ho fatto un errore negli anni dell'adolescenza. Detto questo, mi sono subito appassionata a questo progetto, tu lo sai, e mi dispiace se in qualche modo come amministrazione non vi siamo potuti essere accanto, aiutarvi economicamente, ma so che è il primo anno per voi forse un esperimento, per me io vedo già lo sviluppo di questo progetto. Mi è piaciuto il nome Domus perché richiama le nostre tradizioni anche nel nome, nella lingua latina, ma poi ha uno sguardo ampio e stasera, ma in tutti questi mesi Galatina è stata appunto la casa di tutti questi ospiti internazionali, e ringraziamento nostro di amministrazione, ma credo di tutta la città, che pian piano sta scoprendo questo progetto, va a te, Romina e a Gigi. Quindi grazie a voi e buona permanenza qui a Galatina.
Grazie mille di essere passata. She said thank you for all the project, for organize everything, for welcome all of you, and of course sorry that we couldn't support this project this year with our financial, even maybe intellectual support, ma magari l'anno prossimo.
Lo segniamo.
Maybe next year. E visto tutte le persone che stanno venendo, insomma, magari è chiaro che con il vostro supporto possiamo essere ancora più forti, con il supporto delle istituzioni locali, altrimenti insomma rimane un'iniziativa privata e indipendente. Invece le istituzioni servono appunto anche a raggiungere un pubblico più ampio, e quindi speriamo veramente, per noi in ogni caso, al di là dell'aspetto economico, perché vedi, nonostante tutto ce l'abbiamo fatta, però a parte questo, per noi è proprio importante coinvolgervi intellettualmente, cioè che siate voi poi che dirigete questa città, e noi lo facciamo anche per questa città. Siamo sparsi in tutta Galatina, abbiamo occupato fisicamente i vostri hotel, appunto tutto il gruppo dei francesi, che non è finito qua, ne arriveranno altri tra domani e dopodomani, quindi saranno numerosi, dormono, vivono nei vostri alberghi, nelle vostre case anche, con i vostri abitanti, incrementando quindi anche l'aspetto commerciale e turistico della città, e chiaramente culturale, perché appunto la loro presenza qui è anche in rappresentanza poi di tutti i legami che loro creano anche con le istituzioni di Kiev, di Parigi. E quindi inviterei a questo punto le istituzioni invece nostrane, quindi Angelo, Maria Monaco, se vuoi venire. Io direi, ragazzi, se volete tutti e tre, magari mettetevi già qua, così possiamo fare appunto un no. Venite, anche Alberto, venite tutti e tre. Vieni anche tu, però. Così almeno possiamo, magari vi mettete tu, che inizi per primo, ti puoi sedere vicino a Mauro se devi...
Traduzioni facciamo?
Stiamo facendo tutto in inglese, perché il pubblico presente parla, anche gli italiani parlano in inglese, però visto che si affacciano dei curiosi, entrate, perché noi in realtà siamo in Italia e parliamo in italiano e al limite traduciamo, quindi venite, sedetevi, accomodatevi, perché abbiamo bisogno anzi di galatinesi e salentini.
Magari facciamo una sintesi poi in italiano.
In italiano?
Ah,
quindi parli
in magari...
inglese.
Allora, innanzitutto buonasera a tutti. Je suis désolé, mais je ne parle pas français. Well, I can try to give my paper, my presentation in English. Since
e io traduco in italiano, però facciamo
ago,
così siamo proprio...
10 years ago I studied at the Warburg Institute in London, so maybe some English word is still in my mind. Well, first of all I want to thank Romina, Mauro, Gigi and Annunzia for inviting me, to give me the opportunity to speak about this extremely interesting topic, subject, which anyway is very far from my art historical interests. I teach history of art at the Academy of Fine Arts in Lecce, and my specialization is the 16th century and 17th century Italy. So I study iconography, basically.
Traduco.
Iconology. E
perché poi mi scordo.
Allora, io faccio...
Fai due.
Un po', conoscete l'inglese?
Allora, innanzitutto ho fatto i miei ringraziamenti e dico che sono un docente dell'Accademia di Belle Arti di Lecce, dove insegno storia dell'arte moderna, quindi mi occupo dei secoli XVI e XVII, sostanzialmente Rinascimento e Barocco. E la mia specializzazione è l'iconografia e l'iconologia, cioè la scienza che si occupa di capire il significato delle immagini all'interno di un contesto e di un periodo storico. Mi ha molto attratto questo tema della censura, e quando sono stato invitato a conferire con il mio contributo, allora mi sono interrogato innanzitutto che cosa può essere interessante nell'ottica di questa serata. E ho cercato di fare ordine, insomma, tra le cose che studio, magari i tempi me li gestisco.
Ah no, scusa, solo perché però uno sbaglia.
Allora ho cercato di porvi la domanda, no? Allora, dove si può iniziare a parlare di censura nella storia dell'arte italiana e in particolar modo del Rinascimento? Which is the starting point of censorship in the Italian history of art in the Renaissance? And so it is very curious that the starting point is the starting point of each history of art book. Of each book of history of art on Renaissance. When we start to study Renaissance art, we start from Masaccio, Cappella Brancacci, which is a chapel in Florence who was painted in the 20s of the 15th century by one of the most important painters of Renaissance, no? The one who with Donatello and Alberti gave start to Renaissance, basically. And you can go on the next one. And this is a starting point. Allora, mi sono posto una domanda. Quale può essere il mio contributo storico dell'arte del Rinascimento su questo tema della censura in questo contesto? Il punto di partenza è stata una delle prime immagini che si incontrano nei manuali di storia dell'arte del Rinascimento, cioè la cacciata dal paradiso di Adamo ed Eva, che è stata affrescata da Masaccio, uno dei protagonisti del Rinascimento fiorentino, che fu attivo appunto negli anni 20 del 400, in questa chiesa di Firenze, in Santa Maria del Carmine, nella Cappella Brancacci, per una serie di committenti. Ma non è semplicemente il discorso della censura, cioè della copertura attraverso le foglie di fico dei genitali di Adamo o Eva che si copre il corpo. Noi possiamo declinare il tema della censura in tre modi attraverso queste immagini. We can approach the topic of censorship through these images in three levels. First of all, there is the censorship of emotion, which is Adam, who is feeling shame. The second level is the physical censorship, Eve. She's feeling shame because of her body, according to the Bible, to the first book of the Bible, because when Eve ate the apple and gave the apple to Adam, God said, "You shame on you." And so this is the censorship, our self-censorship, through the feeling of shame. The third level is an historical censorship, which is what from the outside, no, was censored. Allora, si può vedere queste immagini, si possono considerare tre livelli di censura, a mio avviso. C'è una censura emotiva, quindi quella di autocensura, ed è il caso di Adamo che si sta vergognando di quello che sta accadendo. Non è l'iconografia della disperazione questa, perché l'iconografia della disperazione del Rinascimento è portarsi le mani in testa, mentre invece Adamo si sta coprendo la faccia. Quindi è un'autocensura, è provare vergogna di un proprio sentimento. La declinazione della vergogna è del tutto fisica nel caso di Eva, la quale si copre il corpo, le pudenda, che sono la prima cosa che vedono come parte peccaminosa del proprio corpo nel momento in cui hanno questa rivelazione da parte di Dio che li caccia dal paradiso terrestre. E il terzo livello della censura su questo tipo di immagine è quella storica, apportata dall'esterno, che è il frutto della controriforma, che è quella circostanza, diciamo, complessa, storica, che riguarda tantissimo la società europea, in particolar modo la società italiana e la nostra cultura. Noi siamo i figli della Controriforma, cioè di questo tentativo da parte della Chiesa di Roma di arginare altre possibilità di interpretazioni del cristianesimo e del testo sacro, che mette in atto attraverso un concilio che si terrà a Trento appunto dal 1545 al 1563, metterà in atto tutta una serie di strategie per arginare sostanzialmente la libertà espressiva degli artisti e la libertà di invenzione degli artisti. Quindi è importantissimo il concetto di controriforma, la controriforma non soltanto come questione storica di limitazione del pensiero e della libertà del pensiero dell'Occidente europeo, dell'Occidente moderno, ma anche dal punto di vista proprio della ricerca e della sperimentazione da parte degli artisti. So, the third level is very important because it links with the historical phenomenon of counter-reformation, which is not only about religion, but also about the creativity and freedom of artists of develop their art. Okay? And we can go on. The most important work of art of Renaissance, who was a victim of the Counter-Reformation, obviously, is The Last Judgment. And it's very funny to link this with one of the exhibitions held in Venice in 2013, which was called Last Judgment, which was censored not by the curator of the exhibition itself, the director of the exhibition itself. So the never-ending history of the censorship on Michelangelo's Last Judgment. And, you know, it was painted between 35 and 41, but Michelangelo was so an important artist that in Rome they wait that Michelangelo died, and only after the death of Michelangelo in 1564, so they allowed another painter to color the nudity, the physical bodies of this positive one. It was Daniele de Volterra, was called the Braghettone, cioè the painter of trousers, basically. And quindi la grande vittima, insomma, della censura della Controriforma è proprio l'ultimo giudizio universale di Michelangelo, no? E si aspettò la morte di Michelangelo nel 64, nel 65 fu data commissione a Daniele da Volterra, un pittore che adorava Michelangelo, ma purtroppo ce lo ricordiamo soltanto per questa questione, che fu obbligato a ricoprire le parti anatomicamente più evidenti di questo tripudio invece di corpi olimpici che non erano altro nella mentalità e nella visione di Michelangelo che l'incarnazione medesima del concetto di incarnazione del divino dell'uomo, no? E per questo l'ostentazione di queste forme. One of the most famous victims of this Last Judgment was a woman, obviously, and it's very interesting to focus on her because she was, you can go on please, she put her in a way that was ambiguous. On her backside there is San Biagio, who is his instrumentals of martyrdoms, and she's just kneeling and watching to who is behind the frescoes itself. Questa è stata l'immagine che è stata più penalizzata tra le altre, la Santa Caterina, appunto importante anche per la Galatina, no? Santa Caterina d'Alessandria, la stessa la riconosciamo in virtù dell'attributo iconografico, cioè della ruota dentata, ed è stata non soltanto vestita, ma è stata completamente ridipinta, cioè la superficie realizzata da Michelangelo è stata asportata ed è stata ridipinta. Questo si è scoperto negli anni 90, quando c'è stato il grande restauro del giudizio di Versailles che ha riportato lo splendore dei colori di Michelangelo. Alcune immagini sono state completamente cancellate. Esiste, ovviamente, non sono iniziative prese da persone non incompetenti, ma esiste, grazie per andare avanti per favore, esiste tutta una teorica relativa alla Controriforma e alle norme che gli artisti avrebbero dovuto rispettare per poter ricevere le commissioni dalle famiglie più prestigiose e più importanti. Quindi esiste tutta una critica d'arte della Controriforma, come dire. Tra i testi più importanti, fondamentali, non possiamo fare a meno che citare il discorso intorno alle immagini sacre profane del cardinale, non a caso un cardinale, Gabriele Paleotti, bolognese, che lo pubblica nel 1582, in cui dà disposizioni agli artisti, dice agli artisti che cosa dovete fare, potete dipingere questo, non dovete quest'altro, dovete rispettare quello che è stato deciso nell'ultima sessione del Concilio di Trento sostanzialmente, no? Quindi le immagini dei santi devono essere semplici, non ci deve essere sensualità nelle immagini, dovete assolutamente evitare di rappresentare gli dei pagani, dovete assolutamente evitare che le immagini dei santi possano conturbare gli occhi del devoto, no? So, beside the painters there is who writes about rules that painters must attend, and one of the most important treaties is this one, is the talk about holy and profane images, which was published in 1582 in Bologna, and in this book the author, who was a cardinal, explains how painters must deal with images, both holy images, both profane images. But gli artisti comunque rivendicano sempre un senso di autonomia, di rivolta, cercano sempre di elaborare delle strategie per aggirare un po' gli ostacoli e per portare avanti le proprie intenzioni. Ormai siamo alla fine del Cinquecento, la moda, la passione per l'arte classica, per la mitologia, per il collezionismo di sculture antiche è inarrestabile. Le famiglie più importanti, patrizie di tutta Italia, collezionano reperti antichi, statue antiche e decorano alcuni spazi, cioè le gallerie. Non a caso la galleria come spazio espositivo nascerà proprio in questo contesto. Il modello francese di Fontainebleau arriva in Italia nella seconda metà del Cinquecento, si diffonde anche da noi. Ma curiosamente Gabriele Paleotti proprio in un capitolo dice: allora signori collezionisti, se proprio non potete fare a meno di collezionare statue antiche, il problema qual è? Che sono nude. Allora fate in modo di esporle negli ambienti più nascosti delle vostre case, più irraggiungibili dagli spettatori. E in più, se proprio non potete fare a meno di decorare i vostri soffitti con le favole dei poeti degli antichi, cioè con la mitologia, fate in modo che sia sempre evidente la morale cristiana al di sotto della scorza della mitologia, dice lui. Quindi una soluzione di compromesso. Tra i risultati di questo ambiguissimo gioco che non avrà mai fine, grazie a Dio dal nostro punto di vista, gli storici dell'arte del Rinascimento, è per esempio una delle gallerie più famose d'Italia, cioè la Galleria Farnese, che è la sede appunto dell'ambasciata di Francia, molto probabilmente la conoscono, che viene allestita in questo modo come una galleria antiquaria di sculture antiche, come una galleria mitologica, quindi con la volta completamente ricoperta di scene tratte dalle Metamorfosi di Ovidio, quindi dalle Amori degli Dei, da Annibale Carracci aiuti tra la fine del Cinquecento e gli inizi del Seicento stesso. Ora, il correttivo iconografico, quindi pittori che cercano di elaborare delle soluzioni per aggirare la censura, no? E per dire no, qui stiamo rappresentando le favole antiche, però è tutta un'allegoria della religione cristiana. L'espediente viene, si ricava per via iconografica, cioè vengono inseriti degli elementi che alludono alla fede cristiana, quindi il meccanismo è sempre questo. Sì, il paganesimo poi alla fine è stato sconfitto dal cristianesimo. E lo vediamo per esempio, se puoi andare avanti, grazie, i piccoli elementi che sono quelli angolari dell'affresco, dove troviamo dei punti degli angeli che giocano nelle vicinanze di elementi simbolici notoriamente cristiani, la corona del martirio, la palma del martirio e così via. Questo tipo di struttura ce la ritroviamo anche a Lecce. Prego. Questo tipo di meccanismo ce lo ritroviamo anche qui a Lecce, nella galleria non troppo famosa, ancora purtroppo, nel castello Castromediano di Limburgo di Cavallino di Lecce, a 15 km da Galatina. È uno degli esempi di questo rapporto sofisticato tra iconografia, cultura antiquaria e moralizzazione attraverso l'iconografia, che glissa completamente sul problema del nudo. Tutte le statue sono nude, sono personificazioni che sono tratte da una fonte sulla quale mi soffermo e poi concludo, che ci rimanda al tarantismo. Tutte le sculture che sono qui raffigurate sono le sculture raffigurate nel registro inferiore, sono personificazioni di vizi e virtù alle quali il Signore deve guardare per ben governare il proprio regno. Sono tratte da una fonte che si chiama l'Iconologia, che viene pubblicata la prima volta nel 1593 a Roma priva di illustrazioni, la seconda volta nel 1603 a Roma con illustrazioni, che diventa un vero e proprio best seller di storia dell'arte ad uso degli artisti. È un manuale ad uso degli artisti in cui è spiegato, sorry I will translate at the end, in cui è spiegato come gli artisti debbano raffigurare sotto sembianze umane i concetti astratti. In una sezione dell'iconologia di Cesare Riva, che fu veramente un best seller di cui tutti gli artisti dovevano avere copia perché dovevano dipingere in quel modo, siamo in un'epoca in cui l'astrazione ancora non esiste e quindi è necessario che ogni immagine veicoli precisamente un significato specifico. Una sezione dell'iconologia è dedicata alle regioni d'Italia. Tra le regioni d'Italia spicca la regione della Puglia. La prossima. La Puglia come sarà rappresentata? Come dovrà essere rappresentata? La Puglia dovrà essere rappresentata come una fanciulla dalla carnagione adusta, cioè una fanciulla dalla carnagione molto abbronzata, perché la Puglia è una terra battuta dal sole. Avrà in mano un ramo di ulivo, un ramo di grano, un ramo di mandorlo, perché sono le colture principali che si tengono su questo territorio, e soprattutto alla sua sinistra ci sarà una cicogna che tiene in bocca un serpe, perché questa terra è funestata dalla presenza dei serpenti, e più le cicogne ci vengono a fare il nido, ci dice alla fine del Cinquecento, e sulla destra figureranno degli strumenti musicali che vengono suonati non tanto per delettazione, dice lui, cioè per diletto della gente, ma perché servono a liberare dal morso della tarana. Quindi questa è una delle prime attestazioni iconografiche all'inizio del Seicento del tarantismo in Puglia. Non esiste una tradizione iconografica relativa al tarantismo stesso, tant'è vero che il riferimento specifico sarà dato dalla decorazione della veste. Sulla veste di questa fanciulla saranno raffigurati dei ragni grossi che sono le tarante. Quindi è già attestata, è una foto pubblicata nel 1593, è già attestato il tarantismo come fenomeno che riguarda tutta la regione, è uno dei fenomeni principali della regione, e ci parla anche della tradizione della policromia delle fascette, perché i ragni dovranno essere dipinti ognuno di un colore diverso, e ci rimanda poi alle strisce colorate che si mettono sui tamburelli, perché c'è questa, no? La parte della medicina attraverso i colori. Quindi è già attestata, è già così potente, no? La diffusione del tarantismo, che in un manuale ad uso dei pittori, qualora loro avessero voluto rappresentare la Puglia, non avrebbero potuto fare a meno di rappresentare il tarantismo in sé. E io continuo qua. Grazie.
Non saprei ripetere quello che hai detto.
So, just to say, in this book, which was published in 1593, we have the first case of fortuna, of tarantismo in painting, okay? Because of, if a painter in 16th century, in 17th century, wanted to paint the region of Apulia, must draw a lady who wear a fabric decorated with spiders, which are tarantula. Because in that region spiders bites ladies and they start to dance. And in order to be saved from this hell, you have to play instruments which are represented on the left side, other feet of the lady. So it's very interesting that already at the end of Renaissance, Puglia is strictly linked with Tarantism, also in art. But paradoxically, we don't have paintings, frescoes, which represents Tarantism anywhere. I never found a painting with this. So there is not a fortuna of this, but it was planned already in 1593. And so Puglia is Tarantism. And that's all.
Grazie. Grazie. Bravo. Any question? Se no lasciamo la parola a Alberto D'Ambrosio, so we shift from the... No, va bene. Vi chiedo solo, ragazzi, di essere veramente essenziali.
Bonsoir, good evening, buonasera a tutti. Allora, sono chiamato da Romina e da Mauro, beh, essenzialmente per un progetto di residenza, dato che qualche anno fa, nel 2015, sono diventato direttore artistico di un progetto di residenza, qui ho portato, insomma, un catalogo, poi c'è anche un altro, chi lo vuole lo può anche acquistare se mi paga così il biglietto del viaggio, e quindi ci rifacciamo. so anche portato quello di Mardi Gris che costa di più, magari se fa un po' più di...
ci mettiamo anche due rotoli di cartageni.
Mercatino. Translate o we have to translate?
No, just joking, no. I'm here, I mean, I'm a special friend, there are two friends of mine, Mauro and Romina, they are fantastic, so I know that they know me, but I don't know if better or not, but I know that they have some interest, I mean, in what I'm doing and what I did in the past. Especially about this project, you see behind me the images of this a group of we have. You can go forward. We have some images from this project of artist residency. I did in Calabria, not far from here, in Cosenza, and I started in 2015, and then I've been director. Until the end of 2017. So in 2 hours and a half, I invited there 330 artists there from all over the world, so from Japan, Canada, so they were from Argentina and all over the world. So, and they realized there 1 hour for the city. So, after 16 sessions of residency, we have more than 300 works, artworks, and then we did an exhibition in the museum. We part of them because they were so much. So we did just an exhibition with more or less 90 artworks. And it was very special project because all people live there, 25 artists all together. They were living there for a minimum of 2 weeks, up to 1 month. So they have a kitchen from there, so they can eat breakfast, lunch, dinner. So they have the melting point, the meeting point. Was the kitchen, was this restaurant just for them. And then they have so the opportunity just to work. So they have been inside this house project. It has been project by an architect just for them. The first level, there was the how you say, sleeping room, yeah. And then downstairs that was the area for working. So it was really interesting because for the first time a city was out of the contemporary zone field. No one knows Cosenza. Just except for something historical, but a city with no tourism, a city really no one was going there normally. After this project, it became a city of tourists. So many artists came, not only artists, but many visitors came there just because. There was another point of contemporary art in Italy and most of all in the south of Italy. So you have to consider that in the south of Italy we don't have any museum except for Polignano, that there's a little museum entitled to the memory of Pino Pascali, one of the greatest artists of the 60s, but except that we don't have any other museum. So we had to go to Sicily, where there's some foundation that hosted some collections, but we don't have a museum. So in we had just to go in Naples, yeah, Naples. But after Naples, so we don't have anything. So in Cosenza, there was this incredible opportunity for all the artists, not all for all the artists, but also for curators. So I invited other colleagues, so they came there, and we built something really special, because there's no other project of residence in the world that put together 25 artists, you know? So normally you have a residence for 4 artists, 5, maximum 10 artists, but not 15 artists. So there's a community, and it was really powerful, because they have you can feel really the sense of the community when you have many people that all together for just one goal. The goal was to build ours for the museum. So that was the great things. And also, yeah, I had to deal with all the sensibilities, so, you know, skills, about, you know, different point of views, to discuss about the project. And in this case, we can talk also about censorship, because in this residence, after that, I can tell you more in the contemporary art, but about censorship. But in the case of the project residency in Cosenza, I got one artist. I mean, I don't know if we can talk and tell that he was an artist, but someone that the major asked me a pleasure for favor to put him inside, because it was from Cosenza too. So, and I say okay, but you know, he told me he has his house, so he doesn't need to stay in the box, you know. So of course I would stop, you know, I would have stopped this shame, I mean, of this. So this is a point very interesting about censorship in art, because we can say that with the art, an artist can do everything, but the question is
why?
No, I mean, the question is it really true that we can do everything in the name of art? Is it all is acceptable because we can put the name of art on it, or it's art but till a certain point, after that it's not art, or we can talk about another thing, you know? So, what's happened in history art, I mean, regarding the past century, I mean the 20th century, so the Novecento, we can start, you know, with the Nazi. The Nazi considered the abstract art, and also not only the abstract art, entertainment Kunst, so the degenerated art. It was between 1938 and 1942. So they put, you know, artworks, they threw out, they fired, they put, you know, they put it away. So they were not considered art. But after that, I mean, and I was in 1959, something more or less similar happened in Italy too. So, and it was the Nazis, the fascists was out, so at the time was the Christian democracy, and the fact happened twice. The first time happened in 1959, and the National Gallery of Rome, and the director was the famous Palma Bucarelli. So she invited one of the greatest artists at the time. It was Alberto Burri. Now he's considered one of the greatest artists in the world. So the Guggenheim did his great exhibition for his centenary in 19. 15, I was there, I was the MoMA, and the Guggenheim, and I did a talk about his art in the city. And so now no one can imagine to discuss about Buri. Buri is one of the greatest, no more. Nothing to say other words. But in 1959, there was a question time, the parliament in Italy, about regarding his art. So he was accused of doing something that people in the government doesn't consider art. And after that, in 1971, only the same time as I told you, the gallery of the National Gallery of Rome, always Palma Bucarelli, invited another famous artist whose name is Piero Manzoni, well known for the shit artist shit, you know, the merda d'artista, la merda artista. And another question time about the merda d'artista of Piero Manzoni. But no one at that time considered it was not just a provocation about him, but he was just saying, now artists can sign, if an artist can put his signature in a no matter, you know, context, a canvas or something on the, no matter the media, it's considered art just because the artist said that, you know. So we can see there's many other censorship in the history of art, and especially during the last times, and regarding, you know, the taste about the naked person, so the naked statue, for example, what's happened, we talk about today in the car with Bruno, 2-3 years ago in Rome, and there was invited the prime minister of the Iran party, and someone decided to put, you know, a veil, a canvas, something on all the statues, all the statues, the sculptures, and statues inside the museum, Capitoli Museum. So, and that was another incredible fact that, you know, it is really incredible how, you know, a culture that, as our culture, I mean, from the Mediterranean, from the Greece, and you know, that we live all since the ages, centuries, you know, with this iconography, you know, with the sculpture that means like the beauty, the pure, the shapes, you know. So, and it's nothing had to share about, you know, pornography, or, and it's really insane that someone has considered that some kind of pornography. That's the point. You want to say something about that?
You can say something like that.
Yeah, sure.
Well, it's, how do you say, can you go to the last images of my presentation? It's very embarrassing image. Se puoi andare all'ultima immagine della di censorship on we are talking about censorship on art and on antiquities, on sculptures, no? Proprio l'ultima, it's the last one for time I cut my presentation. Some weeks ago, well, 1 month ago, I've been restored the Fontana of Nettuno by Bartolomeo Mannato in Piazza della Signoria in Firenze. Amazing. Sheaf of opera d'arte, insomma, del Rinascimento. La Apple Censor, il Biancone is the vulgar name of this statue. It was called Biancone because it was sold
piece of marble. Ha lanciato un gioco la Apple, una specie di caccia al tesoro a Firenze, dove ci sono i vari punti da andare a scoprire, sono segnalati da una opera d'arte, ed è stato censurato il Nettuno di Bartolomeo Mannati perché è ritenuto troppo osè. Cioè, ma questa è la settimana, last week. Cioè, Apple launched a game in Florence, an app for children, a sort of challenge, come un caccia al tesoro, fight to the treasure, what to say, and with some place in Florence, you have to check for works of art in Florence. And in the first moment, they put this fountain, which is the main fountain in Piazza della Signoria, and after a while, they censored this image because the Neptune, the god of the sea, is too much sexy. So the censorship on antiquities is still alive. It's embarrassing. Yeah,
I think from my point of view. Yeah. It's the same thing that happened also on Facebook. You know that Facebook stopped if you put something. So.
I have this problem.
All the time. I guess it's ridiculous sometimes, you know.
Because nudity is pornography. It's like, no?
Nudity is pornography.
Yeah, so that's the point. So we have sometimes to stop an artist or someone that believes to be an artist. And to do something really, you know, that is not artistic at all, as the one of Kill the Kid, the pig. And the other side, so we have some censor that, you know, just stop something that is just normality. So it puts, they put something, you know, then you say, oh, okay, why, you know? So you are considering something that for ages has been just normal, and someone now tell, no, it's not normal. You have to see that in another way. So it's something really that in our days, we are back in the medieval age, you know? So sometimes it's really, really, hard to think that we are in 2000, almost 20, and we are, you know, living something that it is really from the past. So just telling that I brought just two books here if you want to see. No, and it's just because they are heavy.
The price.
And one is from the
best price. Only for tonight. Best price.
And this is from I Martedì Critici. No, I'm very. I mean, So because everything started from here. So I mean, the Critical Tuesdays are a project that is still going on. It's about more or less 10 years that I started to, and it's just a talk with the artists from all the world. And I had the opportunity to do this residency because I already interviewed more than 300 artists, and here is from 2010 2015, so it was the first five years of activities, and next year we are going to do the new book for the other 5 years we did. So that's why I've been from the north for Rome. I've been invited to the south and doing something, you know, that normally is not from a person from abroad. We say that, okay? That's it. Thank you.
Grazie. Any questions? What happened with the residency?
You said that it's finished.
Right? Yeah, because I was against with the man of the big
really?
Man. Yeah.
Big man, the
big
major,
man.
Major.
I mean, the major was very special friend of the big man.
Kill
the big man. so they fired me. So that's it. That's
wow.
The point.
Censorship for you, yeah.
It's another
story of censorship.
Yeah. It's another, because I say no. I mean, I was not. You did something that you were not authorized, you know, doing that. So, and I say, okay, if you were against, you know, okay, we call another curator, we call another, no problem. Say okay, thank you very much, and I said bye, and that's the point.
Last one.
Allora, io parlerò veramente molto poco. I my speech it's very short because it's too late, and I believe all together we want to go to eat. My English is very bad and I'm sorry. Je préfère parler en français, mais je crois que les artistes ukrainiens ils ne peuvent comprendre. Alors je non, I'm dry.
In
restaurant, it's a great idea. We can go in restaurant. No, for me it's I'm dry to translate myself because for me it's very exhaustion. I never learned English in school. I am autodidactic. But in 2013, I published this book. The title is Art Media, the pornography in visual arts, cinema, or the moving image in general and web. But my research in this field was starting point in 98 because I organized maybe in Italy our first academy panel for 2 days about the pornography, about the aesthetic of cinema, art media, hardcore cinema. Per la prima volta io appunto credo in Italia ho organizzato nel 1998 il primo convegno sull'estetica del cinema pornografico, perché anche il cinema pornografico ha una sua estetica, e nel 2013 ho pubblicato questo libro appunto, si chiama Art Media, dove naturalmente sono partito poi dalle origini, l'origine du monde di Courbet, come vous savez. C'est le premier, cioè c'est un chef d'œuvre, no? C'est realized in 1866. This is a first, the starting point of the representation of obscenity is maybe old, is a 2000. Beh, Greece and Pompeian fresh, no? And la Villa dei Misteri, eccetera. But the image, the painting of Courbet is most important because maybe for the first time is a real case of censorship. In the context of official salon, le salon officiel, il était refusé naturellement nel 1866, et the history of this painting is very singular because the painting is by first at the Turkish merchant that and after for the several decenni decades This painting is finished in the 50 years from Jacques Lacan. Jacques Lacan, come vous savez, ha acheté le tableau de Courbet e il a demandé a André Masson de faire un autre version du tableau qu'il a, il a découvert le tableau de Courbet. Non? C'est vraiment drôle. Il a demandé à un peintre du surréalisme, che tra l'altro era il cognato, perché era il fratello di sua moglie, no? Comunque insomma era suo parente, de découvrir c'est beau cette de couvrir le oui oui de couvrir le tableau de Courbet de cacher oui. Et il a montré à seulement à petite personne le tableau et entre lesquels Marcel Duchamp. Marcel Duchamp, il a vu l'origine du monde et probablement il a pensé à la dernière œuvre, non, qui était connue seulement après la mort de Duchamp, que c'est étant donné, c'est une installation avec une signification alchimique, etc. C'est un œuvre comme tous les œuvres de Marcel Duchamp, très complexe avec la signification. Il a donné l'œuvre au Philadelphia Museum et le public il peut voir l'œuvre, l'installation avec enfin nu qui il a les jambes ouvertes, non? Il était assassiné probablement, violé, assassiné, seulement à travers vous savez, c'est soit le trou de la porte. L'art contemporain, à propos de la représentation de l'obscénité dans la peinture, dans la photographie, Robert Mapplethorpe par exemple, etc. Le livre il parle in the book I speak about also the problem of censorship in this two frames from the French filmmaker No, sono due. Catherine Breillat. Catherine Breillat, il a tourné.
L'icona italiana.
È bellissimo, dai, parliamo francese, italiano, inglese, ma chi se ne fuma? I sono due film di Catherine Breillat, i sono due film
The Picture, Rocco Siffredi fuori.
Yeah, no, di cosa? Alors, la question principale que j'explique et j'affronte dans le livre, c'est là que dans les derniers 20 années, la pornographie s'est érotisée et l'érotisme s'est pornographisé. Alors, Catherine Breillat, c'est pas la seule, aussi des autres cinéastes, non? Much more, several filmmakers realized films, horror films, or quality narrative films with pornographic elements. In the case of Catherine Breillat called a pornographic actor is Rocco Siffredi. You know Rocco Siffredi? No.
Oh my god! Yeah.
Rocco Siffredi. Rocco Siffredi is like the John Holmes.
We will show you
32 million centimeters. 32 centimeters of sexuality. Okay. This the the point of the change in the pornographic aesthetic in the
Italians love
in the last years.
Italian style.
Is the cinéma d'auteur il a glissé, on peut dire en français, vers la pornographie, et la pornographie il a glissé vers le cinéma d'auteur. Le troisième chapitre libre, the third chapter of my book. Quanto mi diverto a esercitarmi in inglese, che
infatti
non so.
Infatti parla medio in inglese, ma parli tutte le lingue.
Ma io non parlo, cioè, non parlo cazzo.
Fuori grotta.
Fuori grotta.
Fuori grotta.
For children. No, this is Jean Chaudemont, anche fuori grotta e fuori grotta se un quartier de Naples.
La blanche baiena fuori grotta.
Oui, ok. Okay.
This
is stop it. This is a pornographic Italian movie in the 90s. It's a trilogy named The Concetta Licata. Concetta Licata is very strange example of the mix between horror cinema, narrative cinema, because for 45 minutes there is a plot, a history, the dialogues, and for the harder 45 minutes is a all sex film, okay? The representation by sexual acts.
The first 45. Nothing happened.
But the very original point is the old films is the dialogue is in Sicilian, and the film is black and white, with a pornographic neorealism. Neorealism pornography. The director is Mario Salieri. Okay.
Possiamo pensare che era comunque un vezzo, o meglio, un'idea che lui aveva di voler fare il regista vero.
Sì, diciamo sia Mario Salieri.
È un errore probabilmente.
No, se parla no. It's not a mistake, but it's true, no? The problem of the old filmmaker in all the world is the shoot a film, shoot a music video, shoot a pornographic film for beginning a true filmmaker, quindi c'è sempre questa ambizione di passare da un genere come anche la pornografia naturalmente al cinema narrativo normale, anche se poi Mario Salieri, this is origine del mondo, Mario Salieri in realtà ha continuato sempre a fare film pornografico, non ha mai realizzato un film diciamo narrativo vero e proprio, ma ecco, this is Etadone of the by Marcel Duchamp. The last question, and I finish my.
And we go to eat.
It's a droll. No, it's a droll. C'est français. C'est un droll. C'est un droll. Discussion. Ça. Mais alors le problème de la censure, no? The problem of censorship now. In the 70s. The pornographic imaginary, the pornographic films, like Deep Throat, no, is that the first film pornographic for the audience, normal audience, Greek audience, intellectual audience in New York, no, 1 million of people to watch and see, no. Deep Throat by Gerard Damiano, and
Yoko Ono, John Lennon, no? Lovered, and several intellectual artists, because the function in the 70s of the pornographical movie is sexual liberation, okay? And in 70s there is two different group of feminists for censorships and against censorship. Why? Because the first group believe that pornographic movie is an instigation to violence, to women. The other feminist group believed the opposite. Pornographic cinema is a real instrument, dispositivo, device for liberation of sexuality of women. And now, for me, I believe it's not really changed this discussion. Now, we stay here to discussion yet of erotic, pornographic, censorship or not censorship. No, in 2019 it's not changed. Cioè il problema è sempre quello alla fine, il problema è sempre una questione di chi vuole censurare, perché e per esempio una filosofa come Michela Marzano, che cioè, io ho studiato molto il cinema pornografico, per me è solo violenza verso le donne. Cioè for several philosophers, women, feminists, the pornographic cinema now is yet the only the violence against the woman. But the question is why the the 30% of the people that see, watch the contents on in web, in YouPorn or Pornhub is woman. Maybe the last insomma gli ultimi dati dicono circa il 33%, il 35%. Allora le donne quindi sono masochiste? The woman is masochista,
è
una domanda. Quindi allora voglio dire non possiamo liquidare il cinema pornografico come solo istigazione allo stupro e violenza, se il 33% delle donne usufruiscono dei contenuti pornografici, no?
Ma perché c'è ancora il concetto della privacy da parte della donna. Prima vedere un film pornografico significava chiudersi in un cinema e quindi essere alla mercé di tutti,
esatto,
oppure andare a comprare un DVD, che significava come da bambina andare a comprare il preservativo e ti vergognavi di andarlo a comprare, quindi andavano soltanto gli uomini a prenderlo.
No, ma anche perché
c'era un
sì, ma è cambiato, come ho detto,
che
at the beginning it's changed the aesthetic of pornography. Now the pornographic movies is for the woman also, because showed the
preliminary.
The pornographic movie is a mise en scène, c'est une mise en scène avec plus sensibilité de la sexualité de la femme. Alors c'est changé complètement et maintenant les femmes ils n'ont plus problème de voir un cinéma qui il répond aussi à l'exigence. Aux exigences sexuelles.
Ouais,
ok, grazie, scusate per il mio.
Bravo.